So if you aren't comfortable with that, just let Susan know over here. But otherwise, I'm trying to behave myself on camera. So thank you all for coming. My name is Evan Deutsch. I'm the co-founder and managing director of Oxbo. I know that we're in the post-lunch coma here, so we'll do our best to be concise and make this as useful as possible to you. So Oxbo, we are a small creative agency based in Burlington, and we help primarily nonprofit and mission-driven organizations to navigate the digital landscape and drive their causes forward. So as a full-service agency, we offer strategic planning, campaign planning, creative production across all media types, and advertising with a specialization in social media. We are proud to work with a number of local companies and organizations, Public Radio, the UVM Medical Center, 1% for the Planet, the Chamber of Commerce, as well as some global brands and organizations like TED Talks and the Humane Society, Panthera, and Wildly. So that's who we are.
And so I'm Ben, I'm Oxbo Strategy Lead. I'm responsible for all client-facing strategies.
My name is Jay Curley. Nice to see you all here and see a lot of familiar faces in this room. I work in marketing at Ben & Jerry's. I'm guessing in a BBSR conference, everyone knows who Ben & Jerry's is. But I think it's worth just to kind of understand the way, certainly at least my team at Ben & Jerry's looks at marketing and how it's relevant for today's talk. I think the basic way to describe it is, what we do is one-third ice cream marketing, the way you would think about trying to get people to buy our ice cream. Our new pint slices, I hope you all tried them, or our new non-dairy line, getting people to send up. And that's very traditional from a marketing perspective. The other two aspects are less traditional for a marketer, but are more and more important these days, particularly for a mission-driven company like that. So the second piece is, we act much more like a publisher or a media organization, really from a digital-first perspective, doing digital storytelling. Now, sometimes that's about our flavors, but more often than not, it's about our mission and the activism and habits of our flavor, which leads well to that last third, which really looks almost more like a campaign manager, where we're trying to use our voice and the power of our business to create change and build social media. The very cool part is when we get to do all three of those things at once, the sum of the parts is much more than the individual things. We can use ice cream to bring people into movements, and we can connect with our fans to digital storytelling more than just how many chunks this works. Just to say it for anyone who's new to Vermont, Ben & Jerry's has a three-part mission. The first is a product mission to make the best ice cream in the world. The second is an economic mission to give a fair return to our shareholders and stakeholders. And the third is a social mission, which is really to use the power of business operations themselves to create progressive change in the world. And those are all at equal parts, not like one is more important. So that's kind of, what we're up to each day, and as it relates to authentic storytelling using modern tools.
So the title of this talk is Using New Media Tools to Drive Authenticity, which we are acutely aware does not sound especially authentic in itself. So that's actually an exercise that we'll go through later in the session as to meanings of the group based on what we've learned in the next 30, 40 minutes. So we both strive to create authentic brands to human conversation from an agency perspective and as a global, very successful, socially responsible brand like Ben & Jerry's. And so what we want to discuss today is what exactly is an authentic brand conversation? So what does that look like? Why is it especially essential today? And how these conversations are no longer exclusive to large companies with massive marketing and media budgets, and how they're now accessible to small mom-and-pop shops and locally owned organizations here. So as we go through this, I'd encourage you to give some thought to how these concepts apply to your own organization. And in the second half, we'll actually ask a few brave volunteers to share some of your communications and marketing challenges. And hopefully we can do a kind of collective lightning session to come up with some solutions.
So this is basically the plan for today. I think we'll both kind of share our perspectives. And Ben from the kind of small agency perspective, and Ben and Jerry from the larger global business perspective. We'll kind of talk through at least some of the work that they do and why it's important to and how we have Ben and Jerry's approach.
Yeah, so we're also going to get a little meta here. We're going to be collecting data for you all in the background, and we'll show you what that looks like in the end here. At the end, we'll share some work and have some demos that we can play around with and kind of drive that interactivity of the session. So I think we can basically dive into it here. So to frame this conversation, we basically want to show a short video. You may have seen it, but you likely have heard of it at this point. But I think we can just dive in.
The entire movement for their own purposes. It's not commercial. It's not about commercialism.
Yeah, absolutely.
Anything else? It's completely different.
Exactly.
It's so staged. It's so shot.
Yeah. So we'll deconstruct this a little bit more. But for now, we'll just leave this as kind of the shining example of a big, big mess at an attempt.
Thank you. So, this was released about a month ago or something, and the timing was just interesting, and we just want to share some work that we did last month. And before I do, let me just be very, very clear. We are not saying that we're any better than Pepsi. We're not saying what we did is perfect, far from it. But I do think we can talk a little bit about what we did, why we did it, and then what the results were because of that. So we I guess it was only 2 or 3 weeks ago, we went down to DC as part of the People's Climate March. And this is not our first rodeo, literally. You know, we went to the Climate March in New York in 2014, and Ben and Jerry's has been involved with issues around climate change and environmental stewardship before that. Our goal of going down to the march was to use our voice to bring that movement to all of our fans around the country and around the world so they could be involved. It wasn't to sell ice cream. And to do that, first of all, you know, we have internal practices around carbon reduction, carbon pricing, and all that good stuff. But we needed to really do it. And so we brought 50 employees, took the Amtrak from Essex down to DC, who actually marched. And one of the things that we wanted to do was figure out how can we bring this moment, this critical gathering of the climate movement, to our tens of millions of fans around the country and around the world. And that was our goal. That was kind of the brief, if you will, and that's what we set out to do. And then, really to bring it home to what we're talking about today, the tools that we have as a business to be able to connect stories to those consumers, they're, relatively speaking, easy to use and very accessible. So we'll maybe just show this quickly, and then I can talk a little bit more about what we did. Start at that scene. what we were trying to achieve. And for us, it was bringing people into the movement. And for Pepsi, I mean, to try to put some kind of positive spin on it, it was to try to be part of culture. You know, I'm not exactly sure, but they started in very different places. And I think Pepsi was going to measure their results on how much soda they sold. And we measured our results on how many people we reached and how many people signed up to take action. Yeah.
The content just from the march, and it had a 65% open rate.
and maybe 65% of the world. So it's just a real example of, I guess, humanizing or simplifying big data. Really, it's really just thinking about what are your fans actually going to care about? How can you deliver those relevant messages to them? And they will tell you through their actions, whether it's engaging on a post in social media or clicking on an email or what they do on your website. And certainly if you have storefronts, you can weave that into the equation. So, you know, that's just kind of an example of using that of how we're able to deliver relevant content to people. I think, you know, transitioning for a second in terms of what is authenticity and why is it needed. I think, to a degree, we have a luxury at Ben & Jerry's that we have Ben and Jerry, who are two real guys who started the business 39 years ago. At least when they first started, they weren't quite there, but really developed an ethos around what they wanted that business to be. And over the years, it's been you know, our job to be stewards of that vision, but to bring it forward and make it contemporary. One of the best things that ever happened to Ben & Jerry's is we weren't built with big media budgets, as I'm sure most of you guys weren't either. And it wasn't about big television commercials like PepsiCo. It was about the guys jumping in a cowmobile and driving around the country sampling ice cream. They were doing experiential marketing before there was such a term. What that meant is our brand has always been multi-layered and dynamic. And that's what really authenticity is. And over the last 5-10 years, as the way people consume media has entirely changed, it's become increasingly important. I mean, just think about it very basically from like a friend level. You're scrolling through Instagram or your Facebook feed, and your friend posts their favorite shirt every day and just says, oh, here's my blue shirt today, here's my white shirt today. You're gonna soon stop following that friend. Like, if it's your brother or something and you have to, you'll still follow him. You're not gonna be liking those posts. You're not gonna be caring. That's a single thing, and it's really quite boring. We have relationships with people, not for singular dimensions. We have relationships with people because, you know, we enjoy hanging out with them, or we enjoy doing activities with them, or a myriad of reasons that we hang out with people. And the relationships that you create with your customers from your brand has to be that way too. It has to be multi-layered, it has to be dynamic. And that's where authenticity comes from. It comes from, you know, ultimately, a brand is a collective of the values and experiences of the people, its heritage and its culture. And that's what you want to crystallize as best you can. That's what you want to evolve as best you can. But those are the stories that you want to tell. And people's bullshit detectors are pretty good. When you go out authentically with who you are, you'll trip, you'll fall. Not everyone's going to like it. But at least you're being who you are. And ultimately, people understand that. And that, at least to me, from a business perspective, is what authenticity is.
So I want to bring it back to the Pepsi ad. Hopping on Jay's example of how to do authenticity. Obviously, this is not the way to do it. And one of the big reasons is that they miss something. They miss something called an insight. And an insight is a simple, true, universal aspect of communication that sits at the confluence between your brand, your product, or your programs if you're a nonprofit, and the consumer. It's that one little kernel of insider information that's the genesis of all great creative, all great advertising, and all great communication. There's an old saying about insight. Why is good insight like a refrigerator? Because when you look into it, the light turns on. It's that aha moment about communication that says, this is something that's going to connect. Now, what Pepsi did is they went halfway there. They didn't get to the insight. What they looked at was a series of trends, things like protests and cultural checklists, like having a racially diverse cast and throwing in Kendall Jenner as a way to kind of bring it all home for Hollywood. But in the end, they missed this. They missed the entire thing because they tried to string together a bunch of trends that they thought millennials would be interested in, and they completely missed the mark. And what that really shows us, especially with this trend towards authenticity and the tools that we're using, it shows us that we really, really have to pay attention. We can't just say, okay, protests are happening right now, so we're gonna hop on that bandwagon and sell soda to do so. That's not how it works anymore. It doesn't just take the trends, I mean, that's part of it, but it's the data, it's the research, it's actually listening and talking to your audience and making it a two-way conversation. And that's the only way that you're gonna get true insight. That's the only way you're gonna get that aha moment that connects with everybody. And the core of this is really your brand's values and those, and connecting those values with that of your consumer.
So, you know, this all begs the question, two questions. Where did this come from? And so what? How does this apply to us, either as a consumer or as a brand? And so there's two sort of lenses that we can view this through. There's the consumer lens and there is the brand lens. So we'll start with the consumer. And a primary driver of this demand for transparency is brand choice. So before the digital age, whenever we would define that as starting, whoever had the loudest voice and in essence the largest media budget won a place in your home. So toothpaste, apparel, food, electronics, all industries, whatever brand had the ability to pay the most for the most visibility ended up winning the day. And what's different now is with the evolution of digital and basically unlimited real-time access to information that we, the consumer, have. What's different is that we now have a choice. And so we decide on what content we take in, and we research brands, and we share our opinions with friends, formally and informally. And we now base our purchase patterns more on informed personal beliefs than was ever the case before. And in essence, I mean, people want to feel good about what they're buying. They think that what we think and are correct, and that what we purchase, in a way, says something. On the other side of the equation, this evolution of digital and also more universal access to information also gives brands a new opportunity to reach prospective customers, as well as a new responsibility in what that conversation is. And so, believe it or not, all brands, as we have been mentioning, small or large, have access to these tools, these strategies, and these abilities to understand their audiences and share an intentional message. And the barrier to entry for this, for these intelligent, authentic marketing conversations, is basically becoming lower and lower every day. It's more and more accessible than it ever has been before. So part two, what does this mean? So what? So this combination of increased customer choice and increased brand access to consumers means that in order for brands to stand out and catch the attention of their customers and prospective customers, they now need to differentiate by values, not just by new product features or cost or visibility. And so Ben mentioned how new media tools help us to segment better, not just by demographic, but by behavior. And we see this as being very reflective of a shift in brand focus, a shift where corporate values are no longer sort of an addendum to the vision, but actually a public, public-facing central piece to your corporate positioning or organizational positioning. So, you know, with that in mind, I mean, there's, of course, a lot of talk about the millennial consumer and how there's this new customer base that suddenly cares about social responsibility and the products they buy and the organizations they support. And in reality, this new consumer in general values corporate responsibility and transparency, and people are showing a propensity to making purchases that are aligned with their personal beliefs across demographics, across industries. So what this really says is that in order to differentiate, brands small and large, organizations small and large, now need to have a reason for being and need to clearly communicate that reason to consumers who they over time discover share those values with them. And this isn't just a moral decision either, so I think it's easy to focus on that at this conference. But across industries and some of the largest and most successful companies in the world, we are all seeing that profit profitability is closely following this decision to share values and be socially responsible as a corporation. So for all these reasons, basically socially responsible business is not the way of tomorrow. It's here, and it's essential for brands and organizations of all sizes.
And I think I'll just try to leave you guys with one last kind of framing or process or approach, and it's something that we think about a lot at Ben & Jerry's, and it's really thinking about cause-related marketing versus values-based activism and advocacy. And in our mind, those are very different. The output may look similar, but they're very different. With cause-related marketing, you really start with, okay, who is my customer base? What is it that they care about? How can I build a campaign to get them to understand that I care too and have some impact? And your goal there is really to build your brand equity, to build your affinity with that customer base. And you know, an example of that would be, you know, Avon Pink Ribbon, right? We sell cosmetics. A real issue for middle-aged women is breast cancer. Let's do a campaign that helps support breast cancer, and our customers will have a greater affinity to us. Now, to be clear, that's not necessarily a bad thing. Avon's raised millions of dollars for cancer research, and I applaud them for that. And it's certainly, you know, a lot better than what some of them. But I think what we would say is that to be truly authentic, you actually want to start with what your core values are and who you are. Then think about the change you seek to see in the world and the impact that your business can have. And then figure out how to make that relevant to your customers, to bring them in. That way you can have a lot more impact, because it's not just you, it's you bring in everyone that you touch. And it's much more on movement. And I think, again, that people can tell the difference. If that's really what your goal is and what you're trying to do, you're going to make different decisions along the way than if your goal is to build brand equity. And don't get me wrong, the impact, you will still end up building brand equity. At least we have been able to at Ben & Jerry's. But that hasn't been our goal. And I would almost argue if it had been our goal, we would have made different decisions along the way, and we would not have done it as well. So yeah, just a framing to keep in mind, cause-related marketing versus really starting with your values.
So we're going to share two very quick pieces of work, and then we will bring this back around and rename the session together, and then hopefully get some great volunteers to share your marketing challenges as it relates to this. So the first one, we actually brought two virtual reality headsets, which I certainly understand the irony of talking about authenticity. So this was for Bates College, and they faced a challenge. I imagine some of you here also went to school in New Orleans, in that they lose a lot of prospective students because it's cold as hell in Lewis and Maine. And so they wanted a way to bring prospective students into the community to experience the vitality and community that exists in the winter on the Bates campus. So we created a virtual reality experience for those students. So we're going to pass around a few cardboards, and Ashley will help if you have any issues with viewing or aligning with the timer. But we'll just have that going on in the background. And the caveat is that this is basically a product marketing piece, and this is not raw, quick content, right? So this is definitely time-intensive, resource-intensive, a polished piece of content, but it's helpful to see sort of all ends of the spectrum.
That's always a good sound. So on the other end of the spectrum here, another piece of work, we recently helped out a nonprofit called Panthera. Panthera is the world's only organization dedicated exclusively to saving the world's big cat species. They have offices all over the world, Belize, in Thailand, in all over Africa. They have about 27 different offices around the world, and they all focus on different things. So this is a screenshot. I'm not going to show you the whole 22-minute video. take up a little bit of the session here, but this is a live stream that we did from the field in Belize with their head scientists down there. This was something they've never done before. Facebook Live kind of popped up on Facebook Live kind of popped up on their radar, and it piqued their interest. This is a way to communicate with their audience in a way that they really haven't been able to before. And it freaked them out a little bit. It's a big risk. It opens you up to a lot of things, like technical difficulties, like no one asking a question if you're repeating questions. And then it's up there for the world to see. But what they got out of it was massive amounts of comments, massive amount of engagement. It helped them reach their fundraising goal for the campaign we were running at the time. And now it's a part of their overall strategy. Because they had such great response to people wanting to be involved and wanting to ask questions and look inside under the hood of what they're actually doing, we're now doing programs like this all over the world. And this took 2 days of preparation, really just to make sure our data stream was going well. And outside of that, it costs no money. It's a little bit of a risk, but with these new tools, this barrier is really low. And it's something that, yeah, a global organization can do, but so can all of you and so can we.
All right, so that's kind of all we'll share as our primary content here. So let's circle back. Let's talk about renaming this session. Using new media tools to drive authenticity. How can we make that real? It takes a few minutes. So just throw out any ideas, synonyms, antonyms, whatever you see.
Use authenticity.
Using so all of the tools to tell your story.
So authenticity is bad. That's just not a good word to describe.
To tell your
whole story.
Well, raw. Cool tools for being real.
Pretty real.
Like,
yeah.
So, take a risk and get real.
So risk taking. Yep.
Ben and Evan invited me to join this workshop, so I wasn't part of the initial workshop naming, so I'll log one out. Connecting real stories with real people.
Sorry, my handwriting's awful. We'll put this on the website.
Bring your passion and values into your story.
Folks, just to let you know, we're going to be taking back the headsets just over here. They're going to be working on another little thing for you all. But if you do want to try it out and you didn't get a chance to, go ahead and see Ashley and John over here. They're going to hook you up with the headset.
Your story?
Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. So, let's see. Does anybody want to take a stab at picking the best of all of these, and we'll put this as the headline on the website that we'll share with you for this session.
Cool tools for being real.
Yeah.
I mean, I think, but your presentation was more about, wasn't actually about the specific tools. It was about how you connect authentically with your people. So that's what I would say. I would say connect. You would put the authentic in a different place, and then it makes it, you know. So it's about connecting authentically with your people.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. We really wanted to steer clear of a focus on the tools. They're not always accessible to everybody. They're
changing
all the time. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So can you say that one more time?
Connecting really authentically with your people.
Important word there, though, because, you know, when you're sharing your passion with your, you know, somehow, instead of cool tools for being real, to share your passion or something, I don't know how, but that's, I think that's you know, Ben and Jerry is passionate about making change, and that's caring for. Other companies are passionate about selling sugary soda. That's their passion. That's what they express.
Mm-hmm. I would just add that in Vermont, authenticity is really our greatest asset. You know, overused or not, you know, Vermont companies don't have to try hard to be real, we just are. And I think it's more about connecting with your audience from where you are. We have something here in Vermont that people, you know, companies across the country would kill for. So I think, you know, possibly a little bit of a shift in the focus to, you know, your authenticity being your greatest asset and how to put it to work for you. We don't have to try. That's the thing about authenticity. You don't have to, you can't fake it.
Mm-hmm. About replacing authenticity with purpose? Connecting your purpose with people? Connecting your people through your purpose?
I was going to say connecting like you mean it. Because you can connect for the purposes of whatever you're trying to drive forward, but if you're connecting because you actually care, mm-hmm. that's the difference with Vermont.
I also really appreciated what Jay said about creating a, what did you say? Creating a network. You know, it's about
movement building.
It's about platform design. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I think Jay's nails it though. Connecting real stories to real people is real. This is normal language. It's not trying. It's more authentic because it's referencing the thesaurus or something.
Yeah. The process. I think so too. So we'll go with that for the website, which we'll share with you in a minute. But the purpose of this was just this, to have a conversation about what this means to us here in Vermont. So,
can you write that off?
All right. All right. Okay, so let's move on. I would love to hear your thoughts. If anybody has specific challenges that, you know, this has stirred up in your mind, we would love to talk about it. Yeah.
Could you talk a little bit about how you talk with Panthera, people down from their risk aversion of the exposure being high?
Mm-hmm. So part of it's about mitigating risk as much as possible. So with anything like that, Ask Me Anything, where you're basically depending on your audience to do something, one of the big things that you need to be kind of aware of is that you need to plan for the worst possible situation. So, of course, we had talking points for him going in that if no one asked a question, he was able to walk through it. We had a minimum time that he needed to read to it. It was 15 minutes. And if he couldn't make it to 15 minutes, then we had some kind of backup options to cut the live stream. But really, if you look at it in terms of the overall impact, they were reaching the end of their campaign. We're looking to raise $25,000 in a week. And this was something that we had seen through the strategic planning process, where we'd ask the audiences, what are you interested in seeing? And everyone, no matter where they came from or what cat they were interested in, they wanted to see the on-the-ground work, and that's the thing they're hugely disconnected from. They see these beautiful, awesome photos and great videos of big cats out in the wild, these majestic animals, but they don't see the people who are actually working to save them. They don't see the technology that actually saves them. And so they were afraid of the risk, and I think it helped that there was not a big monetary input into it, so it wasn't so much a financial risk, more of a brand risk. But I think the big thing that really pushed them over the edge is that they listened. They listened to their supporters, and this was the number one thing that they said they wanted to see was, let us see you do the work in the field.
Just follow up, was that in a short-term survey method, or was it just aggregating all their social input? How those questions posed? Mm-hmm. What time frame?
So it's a combination of all those things. Part of that is primary research, so it's talking specifically with the stakeholders in their organization, people at their top level within the organization, past donors, people who engage with them on social media. So we set up multiple interviews with these people, and this was a general campaign, general organizational planning for them. So this is a part of the process that informs all of the campaigns we help them out with. So first it was reaching those people and getting those kind of narrative insights, the stories from real people that we can say, I wonder if this is true for the rest of their 25,000 supporters. And it turns out it was. So that the second part there is sending out the survey. And so we've gotten great insights from them. The surveys are continuing to go out. We've gotten great insights from them about what they're looking for. And the third is, it's a fancy term for it, but it's really just looking at social media. It's called social listening. If you really want to know what people are saying about your brand or your organization, look where the conversations are actually happening. We now have the ability with our new media tools to be able to actually see this. And places, and it's not just Facebook, it's not just Twitter or Instagram, it's places like Reddit, it's online communities. What all you do is you Google your brand. And if it shows up, there are going to be people who are talking about it. And those are people who are talking completely unfiltered, and they're not talking back to a survey where they feel like they have to have the right answer. So using all three of those tactics allows us to actually understand what people really want. There's what they say they want, and then what they actually say. Find somewhere in between.
So I'm fortunate enough to work for a natural food cooperative, so a lot of great messaging to work there. Something I'm curious about is how to authentically share a campaign or your values without seeming preachy or
misty. I'll answer that from a...
Can you repeat the question? Can you repeat the question?
The question was, boiling it down, how do you talk about your values without, feeling preachy or being self-centered to a degree? At least that's how we struggle with it. Because oftentimes, it's like, well, Perry, you're gonna do a campaign about climate. Well, why don't we just talk about the solar panels you put in water grid? It's like, well, I mean, that's good, but like, what's the impact of that? And we went over to the COP in Paris as the UN's climate conference was culminating in December of 2015. And there were a lot of businesses there. There were a lot of chief sustainability officers and CEOs, and they were all talking about all the great stuff that they were doing, which is great. It's fantastic that businesses are taking real action to mitigate climate change. We were the only business that was there to tell the story of what was happening there back to our fans. So I think if you think about what do your customers care about, right? Like they want to feel good about the products they want. And so that you want like the underlying thread to hopefully be about the good stuff that's happening in your four walls. But more, how can you connect them to the bigger movements of natural foods or whatever it might be? And I would say that the more you put the bigger movements that you happen to be a part of in front, the more authentic that is. And it's important that you're a part of the story, and it's important that you're doing the right thing. But when you put that first, it's self-serving. When you put the movement first, you're in service.
Plus, I imagine if your goal is for the share aspect and engagement, what's going to be interesting to people is not the solar panels you put in that groups, but the topic and documenting what is commonly important to your customers and your brand.
I think so, and I think that's where I talk about being values-led first versus customer-driven. That's very important from the seat of it. But at the end of the day, if what you're putting out isn't relevant to your fans, it's not going to go anywhere. And so it's about how do you make that connection. I think it's important that we have solar panels and water barriers, but that's not what our climate work is about, far from it.
So one of the main things really comes down to activity. You have to
question.
Oh, sorry. So for a startup or for a new brand, how do you kind of gain that initial critical mass to actually have the audience that you want to reach and then learn things about that? There's a lot of different ways to do it. It definitely depends on your audience. I'll speak from a very general aspect here. It really comes down to activity. You can't kind of put a Facebook page out there, a Twitter account out there, and expect people to flock to you because you had a great mission statement. It really comes from finding the other organizations out there that people that you want to reach or interact with, and you get involved in this conversation. Maybe just as a consumer yourself starting off. And it really comes down to listening to those conversations and saying, okay, this is what someone really cares about, so I'm going to put content like that out there. I'm going to follow those people because I know these are the type of people that will be interested, and maybe, just maybe, they'll follow. It takes a while, and it takes a while to do it right. I mean, there's obviously shortcuts, but the shortcuts, they don't get you anywhere good in finding followers or whatever that means. In the end, it's not a follower base that you're ever going to be able to activate. And that's really what it comes down to, is in any sort of communication, it's 90% about the actual back and forth and 10% about selling. You need to have that conversation in order for someone to take an action for you. They need to trust you enough. You only get that space when you provide value to your communication.
Just to build on it, it's, you know, whatever. Think about these platforms as communities. Think about those communities' value, and then try to deliver that. You know, just an example, Instagram. We were one of the first brands on Instagram. And you know, if you ever want a funnel exercise, scroll deep, deep back into the Ben & Jerry's newsfeed. And the first couple photos are like me taking a picture of our coworkers. And you know, didn't do all that well. But then we immersed ourselves in the community. We understand that certainly back in 2013 what the community cared about. And so then it's like, all right, well, let's start posting good photos, you know? And we did that, and you know, and the more you get engaged, the more you understand what people value, and then you can deliver on that.
So glad you said that, and I really appreciate everyone being here today. I want to ask you a really hard question, and ask you if your value is to improve the quality of life locally and internationally. What's keeping Ben & Jerry's from signing on to the Mill of Dignity plan?
So the question is, why hasn't Ben & Jerry's signed on to the Mill of Dignity program? The answer that I can give is we're hoping to, and we're working on it. So we do have a confidentiality agreement where we can't get into the specifics.
Your constituents want you to be there.
Yes. We're hoping.
So there are a lot of different media apps, you know, Instagram, Twitter, you know, Snapchat, all kinds of things. How do you, if you are a Vermont-based brand, have there been studies done or information about uptake and use of those tools, and which ones, particularly in Vermont versus regionally or nationally, are better return on investment in terms of your goals? Because what I've noticed is that there are certainly significant difference in demographics of the different tools and who uses them, right? So knowing who your audience is, but ultimately, do you guys have any information or access to information about that in Vermont versus the region and nationally? You know, I know that it seems like Snapchat has a lot more of a younger demographic, you know, as we're seeing different demographic shifts with different tools. You know, because I also see that a lot of companies and organizations can put a lot of effort into all of these, but then figuring out which ones are worth the effort and getting the return on investment, while that might be cool, What is actually the spending of all the time and resources on it? Are you achieving the goals? Those kind of two questions there.
I'll just repeat it. I don't have any data. But so the question was, for a Vermont brand, do we have any data or research that shows which demographics use each media tool? So, you know, certain demographics use Snapchat, Facebook, Pinterest. Specifically Vermont, what do we know about demographics that use each of those? And how do you go about deciding on which to use? That's the first part.
I don't either. I also, to be honest, I think that's the wrong way to think about it. If you're thinking about, I think, if I'm understanding correctly, the root of your question is, where do I start? Where do I go? What should I put my energy into? And is Vermont any different than New Hampshire or Florida or São Paulo? I think ultimately, my guess is the answer for this room is very different, depending on what your business is and who your customer base is, whether, you know, Instagram or even getting deeply involved in Reddit chat boards is the best use of your time. So it's really gonna be about what your business goals and objectives are and who your current or prospective customer base is. And I think through that lens, and if it is, you know, hyper-focused on Vermont or even, you know, a city in Vermont, you go through that first, and then you'd be able to kind of understand which channel is the platform is best. At least that would be my recommendation.
Yeah, and another note on that is that it all changes so quickly. I mean, that's no news, but Facebook, for example, kids and preteens and teens don't really use Facebook as a social platform. And it has evolved in the last 5 to 10 years into the most powerful business marketing tool. So, you know, an approach that we typically take as an agency, and I imagine as a brand too, is to sort of be have some level of agnosticism towards the platform. So it's definitely important to know, okay, Snapchat is primarily this demographic. I'm not going to put any of my budget into that and miss and get the wrong audience. But in terms of deciding which to use, it's really, you know, what is available and what's possible. And so, for example, we often will set up templates and best practices. And if, you know, if you're a startup or a small business in Vermont, you might have a social media intern for the summer who can execute all those best practices instead of hiring an agency to manage all of your channels. So there are definitely low barrier entries to kind of test the platforms. I can't say specifically as to which demographics use which platforms in Vermont, but what Jay said is the correct way to approach it. And it's ultimately about sort of the arc of the conversation, not so much the platform, because that will change within a year or two.
And just to add to that, because I know there was a question about ROI and where you really should be investing your time and money in that. And this kind of tacks on to Evan's point that this is really a holistic approach. I mean, if your goal is, let's say, to drive email signups, that doesn't just happen on Facebook if you're putting out ads, because your website is a part of that equation. Your direct mail component might be a part of that equation. Snapchat might be a part of that equation. So it's not just saying, I'm going to use Snapchat to accomplish this goal, or I'm going to use Facebook to accomplish this goal. In any basic marketing strategy, the first thing you want to do is you want to define the goals and then the metrics that likability you're achieving those goals or not. So it could be lead generation, you could be looking for email signups, or it could be sales or donations or things like that. But starting from a place of knowing what your goals are, not from what platform you should use, allows you to say, okay, these are the platforms that fit into that structure. And then you'll be able to say, okay, I spent X amount on Snapchat, Y amount on website activity or in terms of energy, whatever you want to measure it by, and you'll have a baseline. And you'll say, this is what it costs me to get an email. It costs me $1.50 to get an email. So now I know that that's really around what I should be paying for that. And the amount of money that you put into a fundraising ask, you should be equating it to for every dollar I spend, how much money am I raising? Those are the kind of metrics that will allow you to improve those marketing tactics, but also extend into new platforms that will allow you to do this in a much more holistic approach, and that will be a lot more cost effective.
This is going back a little bit, but I don't know how many people here remember what's the Doing Boy Afraid of thing that Ben and Jerry's did. Okay, I guess I'm older than some of you. Basically, when Ben and Jerry's was trying to expand, they ran into market domination. Pillsbury, who owned Haagen-Dazs, who was basically telling stories that they were not limited to the store, managers in the store, or they were pulled. If they did let them in, they would pull their Pillsbury products. And here's this little company, and they did a campaign where they create a support manager is the defense fund. And why I'm bringing up this ancient story is I think it seems like what you're talking about, and I just want to see, you know, especially Jay, your opinion of this, but basically what you're trying to create is a community. You're trying to generate passion for what you're passionate about. And what these guys did is they created a community, all of us who had, I had a, one of those bumper stickers on my 73 pickup truck. And
T-shirts are real collector.
And the T-shirts are just cool, yeah. And but you were part of a community. You were standing up for these two guys who were trying to make really good ice cream and weren't going to get bullied around by some huge corporate conglomerate. And that was a great story. And they framed in a great way. And then they got written up in the Times and New Yorker and all the other little papers. And, you know, it was amazing. Now, they didn't have Facebook. They didn't have emails. But they created a community. And Evan, what you just said about don't worry about, I mean, don't be in love with Twitter or Facebook or whatever, but the focus really, I guess, is from what I'm getting is the story you're bringing out, is it showing your passion? Is it telling the story in a way that you want to know?
Yeah, I think I kind of said it, but I didn't say these words early on. It's like Ben and Jerry's was a social brand before there was such a thing as social media. We were built on word of mouth. We were built on stunts like it's a dough white creative. And it is very much about building community. And I think more and more the way we're framing it, and this is kind of evolution, hopefully in a good way for our business, is it's then how do we drive those communities towards action? So then it's more about movement building. But that's really about, it's about culture, and it's about bringing people together for common goals and purpose. And I think in general, that's stuff we all want to be involved in. And so for Ben and Jerry's, these days, we're not trying to create our own community. What we're actually trying to do is use our business and our voice. And, you know, we have delicious ice cream and we're fun. So, like, people may be more likely to get involved in the climate movement through Save Our Squirrel ice cream flavor than they are from, like, a Resist banner from Greenpeace, right? And so that's our role in the movement, is our role is to be a lighter, easier doorway. For, you know, like the folks that are already hanging the Resist banner, they don't need us. But those folks that are sitting on the couch and like kind of know that climate change is an issue, they're not really sure what they can do. And then, you know, and they're scrolling through their newsfeed, and after Cherry Garcia's Sunday, there's a video about the climate march. That's the role we can play, is hopefully expanding those communities by bringing more people. But I think every business has that, whether it's their own community or the communities they should be part of.
So this is a question primarily to Jay, but please, anyone who feels it. So I guess what I'm thinking about is less about kind of Twitter versus Facebook or something else, but rather, I'm curious about how you define success. And it seems like what I'm hearing when you first said you spend one third of your time doing more traditional marketing with ice cream, but two-thirds is spent. I'm wondering, do you feel that, like, I'm curious how you even came up with that percentage breakdown anyway.
Yeah.
But how do you feel, like, is success part of boosting ice cream sales at all? Like, how much of your work do you feel like, I need to make sure that no matter what I do, I need to be careful not to do so much of my time get seduced by the lure of storytelling, climate march, but I cannot forget that ultimately it's the ice cream sales that pays my salary. So I'm curious that dynamic tension that you must feel at times between those two things.
Yeah, I think sometimes that tension exists. There would be a three-part mission, like I mentioned, product, economic, and social. But, you know, like a lot of companies, and certainly the bigger ones here, we also have performance reviews and, you know, annual, ours are 3+1, three like business goals each year and one personal development goal. At Ben & Jerry's, our three goals, one has to align to, at least in the marketing team, one has to align to the product, one has to align to the economic, and one has to align to the social mission. So I have real KPIs that I'm measured on around the social mission. And depending on what the annual So to a degree, I think that helps institutionalize it, that no, we need to be doing all three of these. In terms of one-third ice cream marketer, one-third digital storyteller, one-third campaign activist, there are times where I'm 90% one, 10% other, but when I look over the year, it usually looks like one-third, one-third, one-third. The best is when I'm literally doing all three at once. And that happens. We're able to do that. We're able to run campaigns that use digital storytelling to bring people into the movements, and we use the ice cream as the door. That's really, we found that to be very powerful. It's always a tension. Budgets get cut. Do we cut here? Do we cut there? I think one of the luxuries, I would say, of being owned by Unilever is with a big, massive CPG company comes all sorts of testing and analytics and all that good stuff. And we know that the activism and advocacy work that we do is good for business. It's good for sales. So these days, increasingly, I can do that with confidence that I'm not sacrificing one to do the other, that they're in service of each other in our overall mission.
Probably have time for one or maybe two more questions, and then we're going to bring up the site for this.
We're part of a small consulting and training cooperative where we're really trying to, our mission in a sense is to promote more egalitarian governance in organizations, for instance, right? Because that's what we do, train people in MFR. So our work, in a sense, is pushing our mission in the world around more shared leadership and more horizontal operations and things like that. We feel like our struggle in terms of like creating the message is that that's just not on a lot of people's radar. I mean, it's increasingly on people's radar. So maybe we can ride this wave, wave of the cultural change in this department. But it's like the people's real world issues are more like, I just can't get along with coworker, and not have this lofty goal of like just changing the way we do business together entirely. And so I don't know, just a commentary on like how to work with our real customers who have real business problems we want to get solved. We think our solutions are good for those. Just any commentary on the kind of stories you can tell, connecting to the kind of lofty vision for the practical customer problems, in a sense, not classic marketing, the customer problem.
So how to balance, it's great to focus on mission and vision and social responsibility, but how to balance that with basically having a functional team like every day? Okay.
A big thing. So, like we said, we do a lot of nonprofit work, and within any nonprofit, a big thing is retention of your supporters. And the way you retain your supporters is you show impact. You show tangible impact, something that they can say, "I had a hand in it." And it's not the overall mission. So we had Panthera up here. Whose mission is to save all the world's big cats. No one feels like they just did that by making a $25 donation. But when you go down to one small thing that they do feel like they've achieved, like funding a single camera trap to be placed in Belize, that's something they can feel, and it's something they can hold and have in their hand and say, okay, I did help do this, and it is part of this grand, awesome mission. But it needs to be boiled down to something that is real life, that maybe it is something like that situation where they don't get along with their coworker. How can you take that overall mission, that this big, lofty purpose, and activate it and say, these are the specific tactics that we're going to use to activate that mission, and how can we bring that home? What are those interactions in an office space that you'd say, oh, well, this would be better if we did this in service of our mission? And really bring it to as specific as possible. So someone who maybe isn't interested in the overall mission or doesn't understand that it's a problem can at least understand and hold that small piece of it. And you get enough of that happening, you work towards that.
Yeah. Just to build on it, almost like it's almost like a lateral conversion, right? Where you want use the doorway that is the problem in front of that person, right? I don't get along with my coworker. All right, so it's like help them to solve that through what you do, but then ladder them up to the broader vision. And you can use stories to sequentially do that. Right? There can be pieces for the doorway, and then the next step, and the next step.
I imagine, I'm curious, but I imagine it's the case that we've certainly seen that a team that has, that everyone on the team has a crystal clear picture of brand day, why they show up and do their part every day, that is conducive to a more functional team. And so I guess in a way, if brands are now being that much more public about their vision and clear about their values, then that would necessitate everyone on the team first being on the same page. So would you agree with that? Do you see that in your work?
Does having a team on the same page help with the communication of the overall mission of the organization?
Yeah, or maybe like lead to less tension or like feeling of
yeah, absolutely. Worth, absolutely. Yeah. Having a aligned at a kind of purpose level is absolutely huge for an organization.
Sure.
So if that's not happening, that's maybe one of the places to start, unless it's just totally falling apart and doing something super good. That's the place to start.
So I think we're already a minute over. The last thing, so we actually, John Portman, who's my co-founder and creative director of Oxbow, and Ashley Wilbur, who's an Oxbow designer, they actually built a website about this session, during the session. So if you get it. Okay, so feel free to go to that URL now or later. Yeah, it's basically, I haven't seen it yet, so.
So this content that we collected before and during the talk, there's also some quotes. We've got some examples that we included in the presentation, most of which you already saw. And then a lot of Twitter feed, Brendan Kinney. Thanks for the really paying attention, were you? They were tweeting. This is with the hashtag #MediaSourceSpring. We have an overview of the naming workshop we went through. So this is some of the options we had that we ultimately landed on. Prime is one of the authentic right there. Let's hear the options. And we have a basic toolkit. But if you want to.
Yeah, so like we said, we weren't going to go into the specific tools, but we wanted to put some things up here that kind of fell in line with some of the concepts that we're talking about, things like audience research, looking at insights, looking at greater cultural trends, staying on top of the industries, especially in the tech and innovation sectors, and actually creating content, and how you can now, because of democratization of tools, build a website like this without any coding knowledge. You can do it immediately with Squarespace, where you can use Canva and become a designer yourself, and they'll hate me for that, but and things like trend watching and industry reports, and even going on Reddit and signing up for things like Think with Google or Facebook IQ. All of these things are major resources that drive all the businesses we work with. And these are all free or extremely low barrier.
So,
feel free to visit this page, oxbow.co/BBSR at any point. Use these resources. If you have a problem with us using your photo, let us know. We'll take them immediately. It's not going to be publicly promoted. This is just for you guys. So.
What did you say about it?
What's that?
Go to the URL. Keynote.
Oh, yeah. It's oxbow.co/BBSR. Backslash. Open this keynote.